I am Brad Keelor. She is Julie Paprocki. Next on Director's Cut, find out what celebrity she ran into on the top of an ASCE landmark.
Screen falling off the door, hanging off the hinges. My feet are still sore, my back's on the fringes. We tore up the walls, we slept on couches. We lifted this house, we lifted this house. Firecrackers in the east, my car parks out your hands.
Hello again, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Director's Cut. My name is Brad Keelor. I'm the director of the Geo-Institute, and that is why we call this show Director's Cut. Every single week, I sit down with a different GI member who has stories to tell. Some of them are personal, some of them are professional, but all of them are fun. If you don't know anything about the Geo-Institute, after you watch this excellent interview today, you should go to geoinstitute.org. While you are there, you will find that we are a technical society with about 12,000 members, most of whom are geotechnical engineers and or geologists, and that we are part of the American Society of Civil Engineers. And if you like what you see in this interview today, and I think you will, you should click subscribe, you should click get notifications, and we will let you know every time we post something to the YouTube channel. It is summertime across much of the land. We have just two episodes of Director's Cut left before our summer break, including this one. And so for this one, we decided to bring somebody on who has moved out of the land where summer happens. Well, I mean, I guess it's still technically summer there.
Just a little bit.
Brand new faculty member from the University of New Hampshire. It is Julie Paprocki. Julie, welcome.
Thank you.
We are going to have so much fun today, as we always do on Director's Cut. We will ask Julie 10 questions, two of which are the same that we ask everyone. And we begin with one of those. Describe your job in 45 seconds that you really haven't even started yet.
So I preface this by saying I'm in that weird intermediary period between being a PhD student and being a faculty member, as Brad just said. So I really don't know what I'm doing at this current point in time, but I am currently learning. So I will be starting, as Brad mentioned, at the University of New Hampshire in their Civil and Environmental Engineering Department this fall, which I'm very excited about because not only am I going to be in civil and environmental engineering as a geotech faculty, but I will also be working within their ocean engineering department as well. So basically what that means is that I get to not only hire students in civil, but I will also be able to hire students, do research and teach classes within their ocean engineering department. So I think that's going to be super exciting. And it's also going to be kind of this new, I think, almost idea in civil engineering and in engineering as a whole, is we're going to start seeing less and less faculty members that have a single position that they're going to be holding, and instead have their tenure line in one department and have, you know, affiliations with other departments, because we're moving more and more into this interdisciplinary world where we'll be working on projects that don't really just have one person that can solve them and have to be really working with, you know, interdisciplinary teams more so. So very excited about that. So technically, I think my position is titled Assistant Professor in Marine Geotechnics, which I'm very excited about. It's like the exact job that I always wanted. So very exciting stuff.
That is a great title, and an interdisciplinary future is, I would agree, much more exciting than one that is not. We ask a lot of fun questions on Director's Cut too. Well, you know, I always say that they're fun. Maybe no one else thinks they're fun except for me. But I'm just going to go with that. And we're going to dig into the fun questions now. What TV show would you most like to appear on?
So I actually had two of these. One was a reality show and one is a scripted television. So if we're going to go with scripted television, I would want to be on the TV show Scrubs. Even though it's a little bit older, I think that that is a hilarious show. The cast is really great. And I listen to the Zach Braff and Donald Faison podcast like all the time. And I just want to be their best friends. So I would absolutely want to be on that television show. However, if I was to be on a reality television show, I would actually want to be a guest judge on RuPaul's Drag Race.
Wow. Two excellent choices. So let's follow up with the Scrubs one first.
Okay.
So do you have any opinions? Do you feel like they've sold out by being on these new commercials that they're in together? Do you have an opinion on this?
I think they're funny because they're, I feel, very true to character on who the actors are. And I don't think they sold out. I mean, I think, you know, that commercial premiered during the Super Bowl, if I'm remembering correctly. I watched the Super Bowl, you know, went to college, and even though I didn't care about either teams, went to college in Cincinnati. You got to care about the Cincinnati Bengals when they go on this Cinderella run a little bit. Watching that, my husband was like, okay, it's a little weird that they're on this. And I'm like, but when you listen to the podcast, they are really like this in real life. Like, they love musical theater. They love campy things. They love each other. So I thought it was actually like a perfect fit for the two of them on who they are.
And RuPaul's Drag Race. So I have to ask this one. Is that just a wish list for you? Or do you feel like you are really qualified to be a judge on that show?
That's just a wish list. Okay. I've watched every almost every season, whatever ones are available for me to watch. I've watched all of the regular seasons, all the all-star seasons. I follow Half the Queens on social media. So it would just be because I love the art form of drag. I think it's so creative, so artful. I think it's such like a, I think it's so beautiful. I think there's a lot of beauty in it. And I think it's one of those things where it can be whatever you want it to be, even if, you know, whatever your definition of beautiful is. It can be, you know, it can be creepy, it can be funny, it can be high, it can be, you know, super artistic, super fashionable, super, super, you know, actor, whatever it is that you want it to be. So I just think it's so much fun. And I think it's such a celebration of life that I would just want to be there. And I would just be shell-shocked doing the whole thing.
So I am two excellent answers, and I'm positive you're going to get a couple of emails from people about this. That's what I will predict. Fellow fans, we'll say that. We also have to ask about the work that you do, whether it's a research question or a practice question or whatever. Since it is fresh in your mind, I'm going to ask you to describe your dissertation in lay English.
So actually when I got this question, I thought it was kind of fun because one of the classes I actually took at Virginia Tech was about communicating science. And one of the activities they had us do in that class was we had to write down words about our dissertation, you know, whatever technical language that we use. And then the professor told us, all right, now you have to describe your research without using these words. And you have to describe it basically in extremely plain English. So that's what this reminded me of, was that little activity, just because I had to sit there and think, oh God, what word can I use for, you know, sand or whatever that was describing it. So that was a little intro I wanted to give about that. But the easiest way that I can describe my research in plain English was I look at beach sand from pictures taken from space to be able to predict what the strength of the sand is so that we can decide whether or not we can drive on it.
That's really good, and that was really concise. And I have to say, this is so gratifying. So when I worked at AGU 6 billion years ago, we were working with NSF at the time and several other scientific societies on starting plain English abstracts, whether it was for, you know, a proposal, whether it was for a conference paper, whatever. And it seemed impossible at the time because almost no one could do it and almost no one was willing to do it. And I feel like we're at a stage now where most people can and they are willing, and you just did a great job. I don't know, what was there anything else from that science communication class that you really took away that sticks with you, that you think of all the time?
So that's the one that I always think back to, is that if I'm able, so, and the thing I want to talk about that class too for a second is that it wasn't just civil engineers. You had people from all kinds of different disciplines. You had, you know, biologists, we had biomedical engineers, we had an aerospace engineer, we had like all kinds of different people in this particular class. And so I think that was the one that I always think about the most, is that specific one where it's like, write down the words that describe your research and then try to describe your research without using those technical terms. But the other one that I also think about was we were doing, there was one activity that we did, and I took this in 2020, so we actually did this over Zoom, where somebody would start a sentence talking about their research, and then you had to, and it was like telling a story, and then we had to then follow up with, the next sentence describing our research, but also fit within this story, because as a whole, you know, all of our research and inherently, a lot of research connects together at some point, some string, some way. So that was another really cool exercise that we did that I thought was really beneficial. But I think that the biggest thing that I took away from this class, and I feel like it's kind of almost like, I don't know what the right word is to use for it, almost expected, is that people, understand science in different ways, whether it's going to be through a video, whether it's going to be through a conference presentation, whether it's going to be through a poster or reading the actual technical paper. But I thought that was a really important thing, is it wasn't just oral communication that we were taught. We were taught how to write things so that people could understand them. We were taught, we had to do like interviews with each other to actually like have somebody else then describe our science for us. And so you had to figure out how to, first you had to figure out how to talk about it in a plain English way. And then you had to figure out how to write about some of science that you truly don't really know a whole lot about. So I thought a lot of those activities were really great. And for any current students out there or faculty or anybody, stuff like that, I feel like is gaining more and more traction, science communication is. And I feel like being able to describe your science in these concise language is getting more and more important as we have more and more people that are starting to get interested in the general population about what geotechs do or what coastal engineers do or stuff like that. So
that is fantastic. That was a great answer. And that was a very spicy research question. Sometimes they're not so spicy. This one was very spicy. So thank you. We will continue. Well, maybe not the spicy theme. Could be anything, I guess. I want to ask you, what is the first food you prepared by yourself? How did it turn out? And do you still make it?
I didn't necessarily prepare it by myself, but it was with my dad, because I want to preface this by saying I grew up in a house where my mom worked from home, and my mom absolutely loves to cook. Like, she has cooked every meal, and she's also one of those people that doesn't like other people getting into her kitchen. It's like her domain and nobody else's. She's like the kind of person that goes, when we go to like family houses for Christmas, she always takes over the kitchen. So she loves to cook. So my mom, when I was in, I think about sixth or seventh grade, got a job where she had to be a tour guide actually to Washington, D.C. So she was that lady, when you go on your bus trip, she's the one that narrates to you about all the monuments and all that kind of fun stuff. So this was like really one of the first times my dad had really been left alone with us kids, really, to cook for us. Because growing up, if he was left alone with us for like a day or so, we would just go to like Wendy's or whatever and have like Wendy's chili and whatnot for dinner. So we decided to get these frozen like chicken nuggets from the Aldi, but we chopped a lot at Aldi. So he got these and we put them on a pizza stone to put into the oven to reheat or to warm up so we can have them for dinner. And in the process of that, because of all the temperature gradients that were occurring, we actually exploded the pizza tray that was going on there. So we ended up looking at each other like, oh my God, my mother is gonna kill us. Because we broke her very expensive Pampered Chef pizza stone that we had going on in there. And so I think we ended up just going to Wendy's anyways, because the thing was exploded and there was chicken all over the bottom of our oven instead. So in terms of that, no, I still actually do not make those, because I have transitioned into being a vegetarian. So I no longer eat chicken nuggets out of frozen bags in the oven.
So a couple of follow-up questions here. Maybe the big one. Maybe there's only one. You got to describe that explosion a little bit. What happened? How did you guys know this happened?
So we had actually opened up the oven to look at the chicken, because I think our light was dead in the oven or something like that. So we opened it up to look. And I'm really not sure of the science behind this. Maybe somebody else can explain this to me. But when we opened it up, there was something about temperature gradients that had occurred, and it just kind of, the whole thing literally just burst apart in front of us. And so it was like in pieces all over the oven. And I will never forget the look on my dad's face that day. It was like, oh my God, like what just happened?
Well, because you know, at that point, you know, I think everybody's been there with maybe not a pizza stone, but something. And you're like, even though I could just go buy a new one of whatever, it's not an exact replacement, and there's still going to be
questions.
At least annoyance here. Yeah. Questions, I like that. So that was really good, and a very good description. And I'm sure, you know, I'll look up the temperature gradient thing. I will put it in the show notes for this episode, and people can click through and learn more. Now, this question was maybe the centerpiece of this interview for me. You've had kind of a crazy year. You know, we just mentioned that you just moved to New Hampshire to start this new position at UNH. You defended your dissertation this spring, I think it was. I can't remember exactly when it was.
March.
You got married last fall. Your husband also defended his dissertation this year.
In May.
So, with all that in mind, what advice would you give to somebody who's currently on the fence about whether to get married or not?
So the advice that I would give is there's a lot to be said for open communication. I think at least in a relationship, if you found somebody that you can talk to very openly about absolutely everything, it can be dumb little things, it can be about problems at work, it can be about, you know, big serious things about your relationship. I think that's a big thing for us, is we absolutely talk about everything. And I will also add on top of that, that Matthew and I also were in the same research group at Virginia Tech. So we both have the same research advisor, worked on fairly similar research topics. So we quite literally share the probably the biggest pieces of our lives in common, and which I think is a blessing and a curse at the same time. Because, you know, a blessing is that I can actually talk to him about my problems with research, about the papers that I'm writing, about, you know, I'm banging my head against this problem. Do you have any sort of idea about what could be a reasonable solution for this? However, it's also kind of a curse because then our lives could very, very, very easily become about research 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And that would be all that we would talk about. Because
think of the productivity.
Right. Exactly. I mean, and it also got to be a whole lot because, you know, we got married during a global pandemic. So we spent a lot of time together over the last couple of years, which is also a blessing and a curse. I love my husband. I love spending a lot of time with him. One thing though that we really had to make sure to do was, you know, set some time aside per day where we wouldn't talk about research. I mean, we would like sit down to dinner. It's like, all right, we're going to talk about everything but research. We're going to talk about the TV show that we watched last night. We're going to talk about, you know, some news that we read today or about drag queens that we enjoy or something like that. So we always had to make sure to like set time aside to talk about things that weren't research and to communicate about other things beyond just our, you know, paper that we're writing that day.
So we have danced around it here. I love doing shout outs on Director's Cut. I think this is the point where we do an appropriate shout out to Nina Stark, because we've circled around her a couple times. I know she's going to watch this, so she needs one of those. The other question that we ask everybody when they come on Director's Cut is, how did you first get involved in ASCE and GI?
So I was actually not involved with ASCE at all in undergrad, which I guess comes to probably think someone else that we're going to talk about a little bit later. But I got involved in grad school because at Virginia Tech, as been to Geo-Congress, we all show up. We all have our little name tags on. So the first time I ever really got involved with Geo-Institute and really ASCE was in grad school, because we have an extremely active GSO organization at Virginia Tech. You know, we all go to Geo-Congress every year. We have lots of, you know, outreach that we do. We do educational tours. Like, we've been to the quarry at Virginia Tech to see how the Hopi Stone is mined and all that kind of stuff, which is actually really cool. So I really got involved in grad school and then started going to Geo-Congress. And then, because social media is a thing, and social media, I think, became a centerpiece of a lot of our lives during COVID to like try and actually remain connected with people. There was a lot of things I felt that Geo-Institute put out there that we could still participate in during COVID. And so I kind of got involved a little bit later than I feel like a lot of people do.
Either way, happy to have you. It is never too late. Maybe that's the message for our viewers out of that one. You could be at the tail end of your career and we would still love to have you involved, or at the very beginning. Either way. One question that I was thinking about as I was putting these together for you that I realized I had never asked anyone on this show. Which major world events do you remember exactly where you were and what you were doing? And I had to think about this too, because it was kind of important the age of the person that I asked this question to. So that's why you got this one, because let's get inside the mind of somebody who was a little kid on September 11th.
So there's actually two of these that I remember. The theme of this is sets of two. The first one happened when I was in high school, and it was 2011, and I was making a piñata for Spanish class, because I don't know why we were making piñatas for Spanish class, but we were. So I was sitting there gluing all these little pieces of tissue paper that were multiple colors to this little alien that I had made as my piñata. And on the news, I always will remember this, is that they announced the death of Osama bin Laden. And all the headlines, because we had been watching the royal wedding. That was the same weekend as the royal wedding, for anybody that remembers this. So all the headlines were all about the royal wedding of Kate Middleton and Prince William. So it was all the headlines, and all of a sudden everything switched over to being about the death of Osama bin Laden. So I will always remember sitting there making this dumb little alien for Spanish class, watching the news about them finding and killing Osama bin Laden. And I just will never get that memory out of my head. And the funny part I always find about this too, is my husband also remembers that event and what he was doing very clearly when they found and killed Osama bin Laden. The second one that I remembered very, very clearly, and it came to mind almost instantly, was I remember where I was the day that they announced the legalization of gay marriage through the Supreme Court case that was announced in 2015. I believe that's the correct year. I was at work. I was working at a human rights journal in Cincinnati at the law school there. I was a site checker, so I checked to make sure that quotations within sites were actually properly quoted, and if not, then how to correct them. And so I remember I was sitting with a bunch of people, and the one girl ran into my room, my little cube that I was working with, and she was like, they legalized gay marriage. And we all got like super happy and stuff like that and went out for coffee afterwards.
That's amazing. And that's why I said that this is so age-based, because I think for me, if I had to do the top two, it's, you know, the September 11th attacks, and also probably, I think I would have to go with Nelson Mandela being freed from prison and the Challenger disaster. Those are the three. And I think I'm going to have to ask this question to somebody who's a little older than me too, because obviously it will totally change. And those are kind of your framework for your entire life. It's really, I mean, those are probably the three things that I would tell my kids about over and over and over. So they're very cool and two great events to remember.
And actually, I'm not going to quote too much about this, but actually, and I think it was even more poignant, the whole Supreme Court decision about gay marriage was actually about a case from a couple from Cincinnati, Ohio.
So it actually
was really, really meaningful and poignant to a lot of people in town, because it was about people that a lot of know them. They're much older than me. But, you know, I knew people that knew this couple and had been part of their case and fighting their case. So it was very meaningful to a lot of people in town.
Oh, that's super cool. So it had a great local angle as well. We're going to ask you another question. I'm not sure if this one was from undergrad or grad school, but what drew you to your involvement in Engineers Without Borders? And then I guess the follow-up to that is, what was the most rewarding part of doing that for you?
So that was an undergrad. So I started, actually, the funny thing is I was never... How do I want to phrase this? My best friend actually dragged me to a meeting. She was super involved at first, and so she brought me to a meeting. She eventually quit. I stayed with it. And so I actually, did all the different, we were a smaller chapter, so we all kind of got pulled into doing all the various different leadership positions. You know, I was a chair of a committee. I did all the vice president. I was president. It was a lot of fun, and I really enjoyed sticking with it because I enjoyed the projects that we were doing, because they're actually water-based. They weren't really, it's geotechnicals, were drilling a well, but we were doing water delivery systems was primarily what the chapter that I was involved with and still kind of involved with to this day a little bit, that they were working on. So I kind of was continued to want to be with it because I enjoyed the projects, but I also really enjoyed the people that I was working with. I didn't travel until my senior year, so I didn't get to meet the communities until then, which was phenomenal for different reasons. But the thing that really I wanted to stay with, or the reason why I stayed with it and what I thought was the most rewarding part, was the people in UC that I was working with, because, you know, this is undergrads. Undergrads could spend their time literally doing whatever you want. That's, like, I think at least the beauty of college is that you have so many different opportunities. You have so many different options. You have so much that you could do. And I always was very much drawn to and enjoyed the fact that these undergrads chose to do this with their time. This was, you know, they could spend hours doing whatever, but they chose to volunteer to do something that can be quite frankly quite frustrating. But I think that it was quite, I think that a lot of the appeal to it was is that you got to get actual hands-on engineering experience, no matter what kind of discipline you were in. You got to learn about, you know, this is how you do a design, this is how you do a budget, this is how you do, this is how you actually implement a project. This is, you know, how you make changes in the field because something doesn't fit, which that quite literally happened to us. So I think that I always quite enjoyed working with people. And I think that's part of the reason what drew me into being in academia in the long run too, is that I loved working with the students when I was president. I absolutely loved seeing these freshmen learn about engineering and be heavily involved. And so I think part of the reason why I wanted to get in academia is to work with students, because it's such an important time in people's lives.
That is an amazing answer. We had somebody from Engineers Without Borders in Minneapolis do one of our GeoPit talks, and I can put a link up to that. It's a fantastic organization. I'd encourage everybody to get involved with it. I think, like you were saying, the connection to people, both on your project teams, but also getting out into these communities that are impacted by the projects that you're working on, I think it makes it a very, very different experience than a lot of people have.
And one thing I do want to say, since you said if anybody wants to get involved, I know that a lot of chapters are always looking for people to travel. So if anybody is interested in that, you should certainly reach out to the national organization. You don't even have to be located where the chapter is that's traveling, because for as undergrads, you have to have a travel mentor. If you're doing project implementation, you have to have, a PE still on the ground with you. Because projects do have to be designed to American standards. So even if you're designing it like we did for rural Tanzania, they still had to be designed and up to par with American standards. So we did have to have all of our designs checked by a PE and actually somebody on the ground with us who was a licensed engineer to be able to look at the projects. I know that is a huge, huge, huge need that they have, is for people who have that kind of experience.
So we'll have a link to that as well down in the show notes. And again, we encourage everybody to get involved as your time permits. We have two questions to go. This one is another one I had to throw in here. I'll go back to Nina Stark, and she'll put this stuff on Twitter about these very challenging environments that she's in May and June, doing research on the Outer Banks or, you know, on the Gulf Coast somewhere. You know, it's very, very tough to go to these places. I wanted to ask, what is the most unresearched place that you've done research?
Okay, so I actually thought a lot about this one, because I've been, as you pointed out, I've been to the Outer Banks a bunch of times. I've been to New Hampshire for research. I've been, you know, Delaware, Florida, Texas, all kinds of weird places. Not weird, Alaska, all kinds of places. But the place that struck out the most to me was the most unresearched place for the type of research that I did was actually the Virginia Tech farm, because we were trying to do a calibration experiment to sort of get an idea about what the factors were that were impacting the satellite images that we were collecting. And the beauty of doing it at this farm facility is that we could actually have surprisingly great control over our ground conditions, because we could actually go in, water the ground ourselves, we could plow it up to whatever sort of roughness we wanted, we could pick the spots that we wanted with the soil types that we wanted. So I know it's not necessarily the most unresearched place in the most traditional sense, but the most unresearched place for my type of research was in inland Virginia.
And you are the second person on Director's Cut this spring to give almost that exact answer. The question was different, but if you go back to Rodolfo Sancio's episode from GeoSyntec earlier this year, he talks about some drilling work that they did on a farm in Texas. And Rodolfo does offshore work. So same thing. It was largely about control of the ground conditions. So that's a great answer. But what about, we have to do a follow-up here. We'll just ask you straight up, what is the most beautiful beach that you've gotten to visit and do research on?
So we did a lot of work in Yakutat, Alaska. So we did do some partnerships up there, or we did before COVID. And so we did that. That was really cool. But I got to say, going to the Outer Banks in April when the sunsets are light. So I also need to preface it with this. So my research involves satellites. So we're using satellites that have specific times that they fly over us at certain times of the day. So we have to actually collect our data during the satellite overflight, because we're trying to calibrate with what the ground is showing with what the satellite is collecting. So the Outer Banks in April was by far my favorite time to be there, because the sunrise and sunset times actually lined up really perfectly with when the satellites were flying over. So I actually got to watch the sunrise. I mean, I've done this many times. Watching the sunrise over the Atlantic is awesome. But surprisingly, at the Army Corps of Engineers facility there in Duck, watching the sunset, even though it sets on the other side of the island, it creates this like beautiful like golden glow. I mean, the golden hour was phenomenal. This glow over the ocean where like the pier lights up with these like beautiful orangey colors that you don't normally see throughout the day. And then the sky is all these like pinks and purples and all these beautiful colors. So even though it's not necessarily, I mean, it's the same beach and I've seen it many different seasons. I've been there in the fall. I've been there in the spring. I've been there in July when it was 90 degrees out and I dehydrated myself, but it was the most beautiful in the month of April, I felt like.
I feel like that's a pretty solid travel pitch for a lot of people. If you haven't been, that's a great time of year to go. The weather's really good. The water probably not warm enough to go in yet.
This water was super cold. Like I wear these really high rain boots because I hate getting sand all over my body. So I basically, even in July, I was wearing like long sleeves and pants. Because it's when you mix sand and sunscreen is like a completely unpleasant experience. And so I had to, I don't want to get sunburned hanging out there. So I was wearing these really long boots, but the water still got into my boots in April and it was unbelievably cold because it hasn't warmed up yet. The best time I will say for the water temperature was actually when I was there in November. Because we were lucky because the ambient temperatures were in the 70s or so and the water was still pretty warm. So it was actually like really, really pleasant to actually walk in the water. In April, it was not pleasant.
And the final question that we have today is the one that we teased at the beginning of the show. This started out because as we get closer to summer on Director's Cut, we like to ask everybody what their favorite summer vacation memory is. Yours is not a summer one, but it was a good story, so we let it slide. And it happened on an ASCE landmark, so that's pretty good too. So we're just going to go with your favorite vacation memory.
So this was spring break of my senior year of undergrad. I went up to New York City to go visit my old college roommate. And so because she was a working architect, she had to go to work during the day. So I kind of just hung out around New York City doing, going to places to eat, seeing museums. But one of the things that I like really wanted to do was walk across the Brooklyn Bridge because I am a good civil engineer and I love visiting bridges. Even as a geotech, I think bridges are really awesome. So the one thing I really wanted to do was walk across the Brooklyn Bridge. So I walk up, I'm like, oh, this is really nice, nice weather. It had snowed like a ridiculous amount right before I got there. So the whole city was like covered still in this like nice blanket of snow. So it's like really pretty, really scenic, beautiful blue, clear skies. Like, oh, this is a nice walk. So I'm like I'm like walking across and I start seeing these guys with the earwigs in. And I'm like, okay, well, this is Manhattan / Brooklyn. You see a lot of famous people in New York City, so could be anybody. So I'm like, all right, gonna run into some celebrity. Knowing me, I'm not the most up to date always with my pop culture references. So I was like, maybe I will know this person, maybe I won't. Maybe this will be a cool experience, maybe it won't. So as I'm walking, I still see these guys with the earwigs. I was like, okay, this person must be really famous because there's like an awful lot of these like earwiggy guys walking around, probably a couple dozen security agents. And then all of a sudden, I see this group of like teenagers run past me, like trying to get onto the Brooklyn Bridge, and they get stopped by these security guards. And they're like, Justin doesn't want a scene. And I'm like, okay, Justin could be any sort of Justin, could be Justin Bieber, Justin Timberlake, I don't know. So then as I keep going, I notice that they have on like these Canadian flags. So I'm like, all right, could be Justin Bieber, which might be kind of interesting. And then as I get closer and closer, I'm like looking, I was like, that doesn't look like Justin Bieber. And then I hear somebody next to me say something along the lines of, it's Justin Trudeau. And I was like, oh my God, it's the Prime Minister of Canada. Like, I am this close to the Prime Minister of Canada. And it was him and his wife and his kid were walking across the Brooklyn Bridge. And so I just casually like continue walking and like walk past them. And I'm like, like a few feet from Justin Trudeau. And I was like, I'm this close to one of the leaders of the free world. Like, this is really cool. So then I get a little bit further ahead because I don't want to like have these security guards like confiscate my phone or anything. So I covertly take a selfie with Justin Trudeau and his wife and kid, pretending I'm taking a selfie with the bridge, but in reality, they're in the background. So I couldn't believe that had happened. And it turns out I get to the other side of the bridge, I go in for a coffee or something like that. I look it up on my phone and apparently he was there to give, I think it was some sort of speech for the UN or something like that. And then his family just wanted to take a casual family walk across the Brooklyn Bridge. And I was like, cool.
Very good story. And that's a great way to close today. I will also make a pitch to anybody out there. If you visit any ASCE landmarks and have any experiences like Julie, hashtag those photos, visit ASCE landmarks, stick them up on the Twitter or on the LinkedIn, and we'll find them and we'll send them out to the entire world. So, Julie, you made it through all the questions, and, you know, yes, it is a feat to do that. Everybody makes it, but it's still an achievement. So well done today. For our viewers, if you liked what you saw, and I think you did because you're here at the end, click subscribe, click get notifications, and you can even look at our playlists. We have a bunch, over 80 now, other episodes of Director's Cut. They are all jam-packed with goodness, such as this one was today. So, Julie, thank you again for doing this.
Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
It was a lot of fun, and you're in New Hampshire with no air conditioning now, and you don't need the air conditioning except for a couple days a year, and we wish you all the best in your new position up there. And for all of our viewers, we've got one episode left of Director's Cut before our summer break. We will hit you with that in 7 days. So I have to ask you, one that's not in here, is your Twitter name. What was the story behind that?
Some friend from high school picked the Twitter name for me.
And that's it? There's nothing more to it?
There is nothing more to it. I was trying to make I don't think it was when I made the Twitter. I think the Twitter handle came, you know, because you can change the, you can't change the Geo-Institute one. I don't think you can. But,
that would be a bad idea anyway.
Well, I don't think you guys are verified. So I know, like, with verified accounts, it's a lot harder to change your Twitter handle. But in high school, when I was a freshman in college, I had to make something. And I forget if it was some form of social media or this was before Zoom, so it might have been a Skype name. And my friend was like, well, you should just do this because it fits right into a dinosaur. And I was like, okay, sure, whatever. So I just changed all of my social media handles to the same thing so that it was all kind of put together and people wouldn't be confused.